Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning. Welcome to First Christian Church on this Easter Sunday. We are so glad to have you worshiping with us today. I'm Reverend Linda Hunsaker, pastor here at First Christian. We are ready to celebrate Easter. Even though our church is pretty darn empty, we know that that's okay because it is still Easter Sunday and we're so blessed to be together. I'm going to let you know that we're recording this on Saturday, but we will be live on Sunday morning. I will be at home with my family and I'll be on Facebook and I'll get to actually talk with you during worship. So it'll be exciting. I invite you to get your communion ready and whatever you would like to share with us today. And also just know that we're just blessed that we are here together in all these wonderful and different ways, that regardless of what is happening in the world, we know that we are still the church, that we profess and believe in Jesus, and we're here to worship God today. So my friends, I invite you to join with me in our call to worship. And Jazz is gonna zoom up on the screen. And I'll invite you to respond with me. Christ is risen. Death never gets the final word. Rejoice in this day of salvation. God's steadfast love endures forever. Alleluia. Amen. We're going to sing our trio of Easter hymns. We're going to sing the first verse of Christ the Lord is risen today. Christ is risen, shout Hosanna, and lo, in the grave he lay. So sing with me.
Joys and triumphs, oh, hallelujah. Sing.
our responsive prayer of the day. Living God, rejoicing in this day of resurrection, we have come together in so many new and different ways to celebrate the strength of your love, a love that triumphs even over death. As we exult in the miracle of your incarnate love, we thank you for the opportunity to encounter the risen Christ wherever we may be. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
You know, I wanted to, on this Easter Sunday, have an Easter children's word, but I miss our young people that come up here, and I miss that they're going to be having to save those Easter outfits for when we come together that first Sunday, and we look forward to that. But I wanted to talk to our little ones in our church. I wanted to talk to Lucy and Camden, and I wanted to just talk to Liam and to all those Marvin and those kids. I miss them, that's right. And for the Vandermeers, all of those, we miss them. So I had a thought, because I'm talking to the kids. I want you all to make for me in the next week a whole bunch of hearts. Cut them out in all kinds of pretty colors, because I bet you have been doing that in your own home, maybe decorating the windows in your own home. I want to use your hearts, your love, to put them up here around our church. Our church doesn't have any hearts in the windows. I want the people here in our neighborhood to know that we are still here, we love our neighbors, and that we're sending all kinds of hearts and love out to the world, because that's what God wants us to do. We remember that wonderful scripture that we say so often, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life, John 3:16. So make your hearts, send them or drop them off to me, and we will have my girls decorate all the windows that we can in our church. And I'm looking forward to when we get to see our young people back here on our steps at First Christian. Well, my friends, I want us to know that we're going to be starting a new sermon series that's called Heart of the Matter. We've been seeing hearts all up in our community and around the world, and I think it's such an important symbol to remind us of the love that God has for us. And believe it or not, there is a wonderful passage of scripture in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, 1 through 6, that talks about the heart of God and the heart of the matter, which is that love. So I'm going to read that in addition to our gospel Easter scripture, the gospel of Matthew 28 through 1 through 10, that story of when the women went to the tomb. But here, this scripture of hope for Easter. At the time, declares the Lord, I will be the God of all the families of Israel, and they will all be my people. For the Lord proclaims the people who survived the sword found grace in the wilderness. And Israel searched for a place of rest. The Lord appeared to them from a distance. I have loved you with a love that lasts forever. And so with unfailing love, I have drawn you to myself. Again, I will build you up, and you will be rebuilt, Virgin Israel. Again, you will play your tambourines and dance with joy. And again, you will plant vineyards on the hills of Samaria. Farmers will plant and then enjoy the harvest. The time will come when the watchmen shout from the highlands of Ephraim, get ready, we're going up to Zion to the Lord our God. Of course, I read for you today that wonderful Easter scripture that tells of when the women were drawn to the tomb, thinking they were gonna go to prepare the body of Jesus, but instead they found an Easter miracle. I read for you today the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was drawing, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. But suddenly there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descending from heaven came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee, where there you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear but great joy and ran to tell the disciples. When suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings," and they came to him, took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, for there they will see me." We thank God for this wonderful proclamation and the reading and hearing of this gospel Easter message. Amen. Amen. You know, I have thought and thought about how it's going to be so different this Easter. That yes, the church may be empty, but so was the tomb. That's how we are welcoming our Easter Sunday celebration 2020 this year. A celebration, yes, of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave. And while this is probably the most important year for all of us as Christian, we know that it is a different Easter this year because of what is happening around the world. I was thinking about what the folks in the news were saying about a month ago, around March 20th, that churches were going to have to cancel Easter services. Boy, they sure don't know that you can't keep a good man down, do they? That if they understand anything about the Easter story, is that Jesus doesn't stay in the tomb of Good Friday, but that on Easter Sunday, God and Jesus changed reality and brought life back into the world. But isn't that how we mortals think? We usually see the obstacles and not the solutions, especially when we are scared, worried, and afraid. That's when sometimes we miss the real and important meaning of Easter. It's not the first time, though, someone forgot the significance and importance of Easter, about how we don't cancel the big stuff, do we, church? But do you know what else was supposed to be happening this weekend that probably was just as super important to another group of believers as the Christians are as celebrating Easter? Do you even think about what it could be? And it's not Passover, because Passover started. It is the Masters Golf Tournament in Augusta, Georgia. It was supposed to be happening this weekend. Now you might think, how does a golf tournament, Reverend Linda, equate with the celebration of our Savior's resurrection? But if you know golf fans, the Masters is like their Easter Resurrection Sunday service. And now they have to postpone it until November. But that isn't the first time that the two events happened at the same time. A few years ago, you may have heard about this story. When Frank Sherkinian, who is the head of CBS Sports, had figured out that the Masters golf tournament and Easter Sunday was happening on the same year. He was so upset at this conflict. He was running around this meeting that they were having, and he was demanding of his colleagues, who sets the date for Easter? Didn't they realize that we schedule the Masters weekend at the same time every year? Let's get to that person and tell him he's got to change it. Evidently, Mr. Sherkinian isn't a big churchgoer, is he? We know that we don't ever change or postpone Easter, even though we do know that the date floats around and jumps. But we aren't going to put Easter on a shelf and not celebrate it today just because we aren't in our church pews. I know this is going to be probably the most memorable Easter service I will ever preach in all of my life. But that's what I started to think about. How really our Easter story, and I'm going to get teary-eyed about this, it really is coming to life for me now more than it ever has before. It has a new, refreshed, and renewed meaning for me this year, as I hope it all will for you. I think I kind of have an understanding a bit more of what emotions the disciples must have been feeling on that Easter Sunday morning. Because if you remember, they too were locked away in their homes, together, hiding out, hiding away, scared to go in the world because of Roman soldiers could be looking for them. Why were they hiding out and practicing social distancing? Well, let me recall for you the drama of how Easter unfolded. Of course, it began 2 days earlier on Good Friday when Jesus of Nazareth was crucified by the Roman authorities at the instigation of the religious authorities. He was nailed to a cross and a sword had pierced his side. The soldiers had affixed a sign above the cross that read, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. Death, thankfully, came swiftly to Jesus of only in about 6 hours, when some crucified men would linger on those crosses for days. That's why they think that some believe that Christ may have died of a broken heart. After a Roman centurion had confirmed the death of Jesus and Pontius Pilate and the Roman prefect for the territory determined that truly this rebel had died on the cross, deserving that horrible death, they gave permission to a man named Joseph of Arimathea, who claimed his body. Joseph of Arimathea, a member of the Jewish Sanhedrin, and was aided by a wealthy Pharisee by the name of Nicodemus. Together, when they claimed Christ's body, they were going to prepare it for burial, along with those women that had all followed and believed in Jesus. And those folks gathered together hastily to prepare Christ's body for burial before the Sabbath began. I think about how they had to act so quickly, how those blessed saints who were there to minister to that mangled body of their master, how the Jewish Sabbath that was beginning on Friday evening, they would have to have everything done and Jesus put in the tomb and the tomb sealed before even Sabbath began. It certainly was not how they would have preferred to have treated their master, their teacher. And they too probably were even risking their own lives because of this love and honor that they did in performing this act. They were certainly risking their reputations. It just showed how much Jesus meant to them. He indeed meant everything to them. And now to have to hurry through that sacred burial preparation was assault even in their own emotional wounds. It's so significant to think about how they had to lay Jesus in a borrowed grave. One time in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus even had said, "Foxes have dens, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." He owned no property on which to be buried. The tomb belonged to Joseph of Arimathea, one that probably he had prepared so that he would have it one day for his own burial. But instead, he gave it to the one whom he loved. You know, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they all tell that this tomb was hewn out of the rock. And that would confirm how much wealth Joseph had, because only royalty or the very wealthy individuals could have tombs carved out of the wall of a stone or in the side of a mountain. It was poorer men who were buried in simple graves. A time-honored piece of humor says that a couple weeks after the resurrection, someone even asked Joseph of Arimathea, "Why did you let them bury Jesus in your brand new tomb?" And Joseph shrugged his shoulders and said, "Oh, I know he only needed it for a weekend." Well, that's so true. Jesus only needed it for 3 days. The act was done. Christ was laid in the tomb. And these devoted friends were safely back in their homes. And as they grieved and awaited the dawning of that first day of the week, so they could take their time and anoint the body in a more appropriate way. All of that story happens before Easter Sunday morning. We can so appreciate the words in which John begins his descriptions of that first Easter when he writes those words early on the first day of the week. While it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb. I think those words are so significant for us on this Easter 2020. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark. Wouldn't you agree with me that before the resurrection of Jesus, our world was a very dark, dark place? I am so thinking of how on this Easter Sunday, all the people who are out in this dark world and who are caring for the sick and the dying, for the ones who usually aren't the main characters in the story of life, but are maybe only mentioned once or twice by names, but weren't like those chosen 12 disciples. While it was still dark, there are people in our world who are still delivering food across miles of country. There are people who are opening grocery stores and stocking shelves. There are people who are working 12 and 14 hour shifts in hospitals, and we don't even know their names, but we are grateful for how they keep going, even though our world is a dark, dark place. No wonder our Easter story is so well known, because only in a dark world it makes sense that Christ shall be raised. So when I read you those words early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb. Those disciples were hiding out in the dark, just like everyone else. But because Mary Magdalene, who loved the Master so much, was completely in the dark as well, her heart was breaking too. But she still went to the tomb. My friends, it is a dark world when we have a world without Easter. There is no truer statement that can ever be made. And so while it may seem like we are living in a really dark world right now, while we're staying at home in our houses, our apartments, and wherever we live, that we're practicing social distancing, we're wearing masks now, it doesn't mean that we're not celebrating Easter and that we're not shouting, "Christ is risen, Christ is risen indeed." We might have a dark world right now, but we still have Easter. And Jesus is alive, and because he lives, we live too. Easter is God's light beaming into a dark, dark world. And because Christ lives, the world is brighter than it ever has been before. Remember, my friends, it's okay to be scared. It's okay that we're hiding out. It's okay that we're taking this time, which seems like maybe it has been frozen. But we know that Easter still went on. That when Mary and the women got to the tomb, it was empty. Easter and the church may seem like there's nobody here on Easter Sunday, but the tomb was empty too. And that, my friends, is what we're celebrating. And how wonderful it is to be celebrating it, knowing that Christ lives today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen, my friends. Oh my goodness. It is amazing to think that we are here this Easter. And we know that we are still God's people who are loved, forgiven, and that we come together to pray. I invite you to sing with me a song of preparation for prayer. Let us sing the first verse to "Near to the Heart of God." Friends, I invite you, wherever you may be, to join with me as we pray for this wonderful Easter. God of new dawns, of new awakenings, of new life, we hear your voice this morning saying, "I have loved you, my people, with an everlasting love. With unfailing love, I have drawn you to myself." On this Easter day, you tell us we will be rebuilt and made new. And in gratitude, we hear you, O living God, and we believe you. So we still celebrate this gift of new life in Christ, even in the midst of fear, even though we may not be in our churches. We know we come to celebrate that tomb being empty. You give us eyes to see through the tears, songs to still sing with throats tight with emotion, And we know you help the weary rise up out of the ashes. Give us then today the courage to be your light, your hope, and your heart in this world today. Help us to rise and celebrate on this Easter morning and lift our prayers to you. O Lord of life, as you hear us lift to you our hopes and prayers for the church and the world, let your grace empower us as people of faith to better serve you in the commonplaces of our lives and in the people we meet on our faith journeys. Open our eyes to the living Christ as we pray for and work with the poor, the brokenhearted, the sick, and the bereaved. We pray for those who are working in the dark of our current world to bring hope and healing. And we pray for our health workers, our nursing home workers. We pray for those grocery stores and gas stations. We pray for those truck drivers and for the people that are our emergency workers. We think of all of those folks who, yes, get up and put a mask on and still continue to help our world move forward. We know that you, O God, are hearing the prayers of all of us this day, and we do lift aloud those who may be closest to our hearts this day. We pray for those right now who might be infected with the COVID virus. We pray for healing in their lives. We pray that they know that while they may struggle, that healing can come. We do pray for those families that have lost loved ones here, right even in our own community, from this virus. And we pray for those who just have those everyday kind of illnesses, the ones that sometimes are serious and the ones that just make us feel run down. We know that in all things, O God, you hear the prayers for all of us that are close to our hearts. Because we believe in that resurrecting power, we have lifted them up to you and give those prayers renewed strength and hope. You know that we believe that you give to us, O God, a new faith which to live these days of darkness with, that we will not be afraid to continue to shout our hallelujahs and be the living witness to your resurrection, made whole by your love and care. And as one community, we do pray together the prayer your Son did say: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. As I invite Don and Sharon to gather with me at the communion table this day, I do want to just take a moment to say again, thank you. Thank you to all of those who are continuing to share your tithes and offerings with this church that I know you love and care about, that it helps to pay our salaries, that it helps to pay the bills. We know that we will be able to get back into this church soon, and we thank you for being able to help support this church in whatever ways you have been able to. We'll make it work. That's how we've been doing it for the last month and a half. We make it work. We do it because we know that we are still church, even though we might not all physically be together. that this is still Christ's table, a table that I can't wait to see how you all have been celebrating around that table in your homes, what ways that you have been pulling communion bread and wine together to celebrate. I hope that this day you feel all of us gathering around Christ's table and feeling the love that comes from knowing Jesus conquered death and rose from the grave. That yes, it might be a dark world and we might be trying to make our way through it, but the tomb was empty and we get to celebrate still today on this Easter Sunday. Let us celebrate by singing just wonderful hymn that I hope you are blessed with. We're going to sing all the verses to He Lives, and we hope you'll sing with us. Today. And we remember the night when Jesus met with his disciples in that upper room. When Jesus took a loaf of bread and after blessing it, he broke it, he blessed it, and he said to those disciples, As often as you eat and you gather in my name, take and eat and do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray.
Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come to you today a little frightened, but we know you are there for us. Surround us with your loving arms. Lift our spirits, Lord. We know this day you love us much. You love us so much that you sent your only Son to die on the cross for us. But today he lives with us. We come to this table where this bread is that represents your Son's body. We eat this with so much love in our hearts for you. We thank you over and over again for sending your Son to die for us, that we may live forever with you. We say these things in his holy name. Amen.
It was after that supper that Jesus took the cup, and after pouring it out, giving thanks and blessing it, he gave it to his disciples and he said to them, "I shall not drink from the fruit of the vine until I can drink it one day new with all of you in my Father's heavenly kingdom." Let us pray.
Your love in Jesus Christ, O God, is the stone we once rejected because we were afraid that this giving, self-sacrificing love would lead us to death. But in the good news of the resurrection, which we celebrate this Easter Sunday, the stone that was once rejected has become the cornerstone of a temple that cannot be destroyed. For we have discovered that your love does lead us to death of self, but that it also leads us beyond this death to new life in Christ. In drinking this cup, we commemorate the love poured out for us at Calvary, but we also celebrate the conquering, everlasting, ever-living love of the empty tomb. In the name of the risen Christ, we pray. Amen.
My friends, we remember that wherever two or three are gathered in Christ's name, we proclaim his life, his death, and his resurrection forever to come. We are blessed to share this Holy Communion with all of you this day.
Thank you.
Amen. That's exactly right. We are blessed. We are blessed in more ways than we know. And I just want to say thank you to our church family for being able to know that you are such a support and strength for me, as I know that we all have been for you. And I have to say thank you to Don and Cindy and Jim and Sharon and Susan and my family for coming together so that we can do this for our church family. And we'll keep doing it as long as we need to, as long as it takes. Because while the church might be empty, so was the tomb. And that's okay. Our hearts are full. Our hearts are full. My friends, share with me, and I'm going to invite Sharon and Don to be my all right behind me. Share with me our blessing, our Easter blessing. Christ is with us in this place.
Alleluia.
Christ goes with us into the world.
Alleluia.
Go now in peace, for Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen. Amen.